begin the question and answer session by putting a question first. Doing a budget for Mumbai is an extremely big task, and I can understand the amount of work that goes on behind the curtain in terms of getting it ready. There must be a huge number of processes, a number of departments that get involved. So I think the audience would be interested in knowing what is the process, how do you start, who are the people who are involved, and how do you get it together? A few words on that.
Fundamentally, the budget is prepared by what is called the finance department. We call it the CA finance of the corporation, who is fundamentally involved, is headed by an additional MC who is a senior IS officer, additional MC projects who handles the finance. The budget process starts fundamentally from at least about 3 to 4 months before the budget is presented. The first things that we do in a budget process is to look at how much revenues we are going to have available. We really cannot have a budget without knowing how much you're going to earn. So first and foremost that we start with is knowing how much money are we going to earn. Then because this year we made a shift, is this time we said before we start on deciding how much to spend and where to spend, we first asked each head of department, so a chief engineer road heads the road, a chief engineer sewage treatment heads sewage, by asking him, you please tell us how much you're going to spend and give us a presentation. Most of the bigger departments, the presentation was kept at my level. Please give me a presentation to convince me. If you say I want 1,000 crores, please convince me why you need 1,000 crores. We'll give you 1,000. If you want 1,000, 1,000, 1,100, 1,100. But you must convince. It cannot be a dream budget. We are not looking at dream budgets. We are looking at what is called implementable budgets.
Before you ask the question, kindly identify yourself and address a question. I would request you to ask a question and not to start your own detailed remark, commentary on the budget. Yes?
I'm extremely happy to hear you speak, sir. I have been hearing for the last 10 years, I have been attending and analyzing. And this was the first time I must be very, very frank and honest without any kind of a protocol or something. It was really first time I could hear a budget with head and heart put together. It was a remarkable exercise. Compliments, serious compliments to you. I was especially happy that you gave focus on the hospitals, women's hostels and schools. These are kind of a neglected item. I really feel all the time we talk of so-called iconic transport infrastructure, but you did give this a lot of important and really the very bottom part and very critical part of the city, and that was extremely happy. I wish really one thing, but only thing, that you had done your part. I hope that there is a really consistent month-to-month evaluation and progress. Otherwise, all your great efforts of making such a good budget should not be watered down or wasted. Second thing which was very, very good was that you are running down the surpluses. I think that is a very positive thing. It was no good to have a city, very rich city, and very dirty streets and dirty urinals. That is no good to have big bank balance and horrible roads, horrible gardens. So I thought this was a very correct direction. I wish you could try to run down the surplus more than 3,000, something like maybe 8 or 10,000, and that it should appear to people's eyes and ears should feel the budget rather than numbers. So I think this was a very good thing. I would like to suggest some, although you have said that only ask questions, but I would like, I'll ask you the questions in the sense, can we not have some analytics? In the sense, I will just identify 2-3 areas. We have got a 2,000 crore rupees, I think, property tax collection, and 5,000 collection, but the outstanding on property tax is 10,000 crores. That is equivalent to 2 years, which is not a very good idea. And then when I tried to understand something, have we segregated the new property tax and old property tax, that is buildings after 2010 and before 2010? And I understand this, we do not know the numbers. I thought we should also know the numbers and not only the rupees. That means how many properties attract capital value-based taxes? And I was told informally that most of the arrears are the new property tax. it is as good as defunct. I don't know whether it's truth or not, but I would really feel that the budget should separate property tax from old properties, old method, property tax from new properties, new method, so that we will know how many new building proposals are passing every year from 2010 onwards. I think that we should have. Second thing that we have got, I would like to understand, the parking, most municipalities all over the world earn the huge revenues from parking, and I think we earn a very paltry amount. I mean, compared to many other states, and we have got unusual, I think the amount of parking that we see free and unregulated road is simply mind-boggling. I hope there is some analytical study on that, why this is such a sad state, that why can't we have much more parking under regulated and paid conditions rather than free? And which is like all the good municipalities use this source for financing many of the projects. So this was the second item we should consider. And the third item, I don't want to go into more than that, whether are we going to have good analysis of the waste management part of it. It was a very good thing that you did last year to send letters to all the societies. I thought we should have an analysis of how many letters you sent, what kind of response you got, by what. I thought this is where all the cloud-based or non-cloud-based computing should do. And what kind of societies are performing and what kind of societies are not performing, how much quantity is segregated, how much quantity is not segregated, how many people are paying fines. And this kind of analytics can be really make a corporation effective. And more than that, people will realize that it bites. I don't think it just can, that any kind of bad habits you can continue. So I don't want to add more, but I think
thank you.
Out of the outstanding budget, these are some of the suggestions.
Thank you, Mr. Dutta.
Compliments, but just two, three issues. One is on the property tax, as you rightly said, 10,000 crores outstanding, but almost 6,000 crore is stuck in court stay. There was, you know, the multiplying factor that we had changed, so the court has stayed the collection on that count. So 4,000 crores is what is collectible, and on that we are now putting in efforts to see that is collected quickly. And as far as this garbage collection, the notices that we sent out, we've got a detail as to how many people got the notice, how many people have complied with it, how many are still complying. There are people who have asked us for time, and there are people on whom we have filed cases against. It's not a very happy thing to do, but there is no option now. Mumbai needs to set its garbage right.
Yes, young man there.
Hello, sir. My name is Sai. So my question is about being a wealthier corporation. Is the corporation capable of the challenge of migrating people? The migration numbers are really increasing, and they will increase in future too. So do you see it as a challenge, like crowded cities and or a positive thing, people like to live more in Mumbai?
You would be surprised to know that the migration to Mumbai has recently been coming down very drastically. About in the 1960s, 70s, the migration was about 60% per decade. So we were really multiplying the number in Mumbai fast. In the last 10 years, it has come down to around 3%, and all indications are that the migratory population is not going to increase the population any longer. And if you would have seen the figures, by 2030, the population of Mumbai might be around 12.79 million, which is just about 30 lakhs more than what it is today. So the population is stabilizing for different reasons. I think if we go into those reasons, we will take a day to explain that. But that's the situation right now. So you need not be worried about too much of migration happening in Mumbai. Yes, sir.
I mean, we as a citizen appreciate the participation. Also, you say that you have changed the budget title. You have changed the participation of various departments in a budget session. I would like if the citizens are also taken into consideration, like DPs, you know, suggestions and objections were taken in the budget. If that's the one, okay. The other one which I want to touch is, I don't want to, one is affordable education, whether we can aim at. See, we are aiming at education after digitalized, fine, that's okay. Because affordable education, if it's not provided, then we are creating a more caste and class difference. Sorry, I mean, that's what's happening, which is one more thing is to be done. On a health side, we are happy that hospitals are increased, but I says we should stop hospitals budgeting. Instead of that, have something that health is improved by having a more public and gardens and everything so that the health is improved. So my aim should be reducing the hospitalization or health budget instead of increasing it by way of giving the basics of The third one is, fourth one is, there are big projects which are coming up, like, which is, of course, I should not say, concretization of rivers, storm water drains various. Whether these project-specific funds are been, you know, what could the budget allocated, what is studied, and what is the progress in, say, maybe 1 year, 2 years, or 3 years down the line. That's also something we need a participation. The other one is lease and something is public transportation buses is we are totally missing, which was there when we came in Mumbai in 1972. So whether what is we can do about that increasing metro is, of course, a different ball game. That's what. And other one is we are talking about digging of our own resources from the 48,000 crores. Fine. But what about revenue generation on that? I spent 48,000 crores, right, but then I need a funding also. So are we going to, how we are going to do that? Because interest rates are coming down, so how we are going to do this? Thanks.
Education front, Patil sir, very rightly said, what are we doing about bringing the cost of education? Municipal schools are almost free. Not only free, the municipal schools also give 27 items to the children, which includes a school bag, a water bottle, a tiffin box, books, geometry box, things like that. The worry is not the cost of education. The worry is the quality of education. That is now very, very worrisome. And this year, we are really going to push at quality. So it can also mean some very, very tough talking with people involved in education. And it is going to come, and you will watch it. There is no go, but we need to get the Education Act together. We can't have the poor children studying in schools, which means nothing. And dropping out, finally, the school's closing down. So that's one area. As far as this point is very correct, it's an old saying, prevention is better than cure. So maybe that's better. But then you see there are a lot of lifestyle diseases that are coming in. However, what we are trying to do is we put money both in preventive care and in curative areas also. So the budget is tries to balance both sides. But then you can't say a poor man should not get his dialysis done. If he needs a dialysis, he needs a dialysis. And he can't afford a dialysis. And it's something which doesn't happen one-off. Dialysis is not one-off. It happens every second day, third day, or every week. So he needs to be done. So that is the area which takes up a lot of resources, and we tend to put in money over there. As far as rivers are concerned, Poisar, Dahisar, Mithi. We've got our plans going. Mithi River, I didn't touch upon it because it will become very long. This year, we are starting work on the Mithi River. We've already got the plan sanctioned. The tenders are out, and you should see work on Mithi River starting right away. Poisar and Dahisar, the plans are there. Of course, river training is an important issue in Mumbai. There is a criticism that you're concretizing rivers. Criticism very well taken. But today, the issue is that if I don't have the concrete wall on the side, the hutments that are there, see, Mumbai, the working is very different. The huts that are there are likely to slip into the river and cause another accident if you try to widen the river or sort of deepen the river. It's a debatable issue. I'm not getting into the debate, but definitely we'll be welcome to any suggestions to deal with this issue. Buses, yes, BST is in a mess, and we need to sort it out. We've already told BST that you need to get your act together. A losses of 1,000 crores every year and an accumulated loss of 5,000 crores is not taking us anywhere. Bus systems must improve. And we are now going in for wet leasing because our own buses cost us about 100 rupees per kilometer to run. And a wet lease costs us only 60 rupees per kilometer to run. So we said, no go. You call it whatever you like, we are going to get into wet leasing. Because why we came up with the wet leasing model is that any service that the government provides for the poor, buses are used by the poor, the price of the service must be controlled by the government. The price of the service cannot be controlled by the private sector, which is driven by profit. So in the wet lease model, we are just telling the operator, please tell us how much money you want to operate the bus per kilometer. Ticket price, we will manage. Whatever is the loss of the profit is in the government account. So you come is just like hiring a cab. So we just hire a bus, we pay him 60 rupees a kilometer, ticket pricing is decided by us, the bus still remains nice and red, so that the character of BST doesn't change. The conductor is ours, so you'll still hear the word thamba ani pude chala. That also remains. But ticket prices also will be controlled by us, but we will be able to control costs. The next thing that you're seeing in BST buses, which we have now asked BST to do, and you will very soon see it, we are asking them to reduce the size of buses. So we are moving into mini and midi buses. Because any bus system needs three fundamental things. One, it needs frequency. You're not going to stay and wait endlessly for a BST bus to come. It needs what is called reliability. So if you know that the bus should come in the next 10 minutes, it should come in the 10 minutes. If it comes after half an hour, you are not going to wait there. And the last thing that it needs is predictability. You must know when the next bus is coming. So we are now putting up passenger information systems, and the tenders are already out today. GM BST was telling me he's just finalizing the bidder. Maybe in the next 3 to 4 months, you must have a passenger bay. On the stop, you will know that this is your bus route that you want. In the next 5 minutes, a bus is coming. You can wait for it and take your own call on that. So predictability, reliability is something that we are putting in money for.
Yes, ma'am. Let the lady ask.
My first question was actually related to BEST, and I'm glad that you shed some light on the roadmap that you for the BEST. The other thing is that, like you rightly mentioned, that the BMC budget is very complicated, especially the BMC budget is divided into part A, B, C, and it's very complicated. So how are you moving towards trying to make it more citizen-friendly? Because not many, like a large part of urban governance is all about citizen participation. But if you have an opaque budget, which is divided into complicated parts, it leads to lesser participation. So are you moving towards a more outcome-friendly analytical budget such that citizens can participate for it? And if you could shed some light on the pedestrian policy that the BMC is looking at, because there is a large part of pedestrian population also besides large projects and BEST that comes under.
As far as making a budget citizen-friendly, there are two parts to a budget. And it will always remain so. There will be one part which will be very citizen-friendly, and there is one part which is not going to be citizen-friendly. And there is a reason, not that, you know, we love to keep it non-citizen-friendly. But if you see, why has this A, B, C, D, E, F, G budgets done? Because there are certain budgets that the framers, when they worked this law out in those times, decided that certain things have to be ring-fenced. For example, water supply. So you cannot take the earning from the water supply and put it into roads. Because water supply is something that has to be given. No matter what happens, water must come in the morning. So there is a need for ring fencing of budgets. There is a need to match the figures. There is a need to, budgets are very codified documents. Everybody cannot get up and say, no, today onwards I shall make this budget. Budget has to be codified because it has to be understood by a very large section of population. And when I say revenue expenditure, me and the person sitting there, both of us should understand what is a revenue budget. What is meant by revenue expenditures? While a common citizen may not understand the difference between a revenue expenditure and a capital expenditure, or a revenue income and a capital income, he may not understand. Very fair and very correct in his complaint. But the issue is that when you make a budget, it's a codified document which has to be done in a particular manner so that the larger population understands, because if you don't codify these things, there is also a propensity of public bodies to then cheat. And that's a very strong word to use. But yes, if revenue is defined very loosely, I can also get away by quoting some figures which actually do not make sense. However, the citizen-friendly part this time, if you see the budget document, we've actually said that let's start allocating money to specific projects. Let's not just say general reserves of the corporation. Each reserve must be linked to a project. So you know, yes, this corporation has got 15,000 crores for the coastal highway. So when you see the reserves, it's not just one big word, general reserve. So you see Coastal Highway, 15,000 crores. You see GMLR, 1,200 crores. So we're trying to also bring in a citizen-friendly thing in the way that the citizen know what's going to drop at the end of the pipeline. Finally, a citizen is very concerned not with what flows in the pipeline, but what falls out of the pipeline.
Sir, can I have one question? Sir, I am Atul Gandhi.
Good evening, gentlemen. My name is Manoj Mota. I work for a company called Banyan Resources, and we are into soft and social infrastructure building and management. My question is very simple, sir. One, when is it that we are going to see the new DP? And two, you may not have the answer, but kindly enlighten us on that. And two, is that we believe that there is a high court stay on new development permissions in the MCGM area. So by when do you believe that high court stay will go off so that we can apply for new land developments to move into the developments especially that we are trying to do, which is soft and social infrastructure?
Mr. Jha was my boss at one point of time. And two things he told me. पहले तो जो क्लास अटेंड करने जाओ उसी का क्वेश्चन आंसर करो. अगर ज्योग्राफी क्लास है तो आज ज्योग्राफी का क्वेश्चन, मैथ्स का पूछोगे तो नहीं. सो डीपी इज नॉट टुडेज सब्जेक्ट, टुडे सब्जेक्ट इज बजट. दूसरा चीज इन्होंने मुझे कहा कि जो तुम्हारे कार्य कक्ष में ना हो उसके ऊपर कभी उत्तर मत दो. अब डीपी हैज गॉन टू दी गवर्नमेंट एंड इट इज नॉट विद मी, सो आई रियली कैन नॉट प्रिडिक्ट व्हेन गॉड शैल अप्रूव.
एक्सक्यूज मी सर, आई हैव सम क्वेश्चंस ऑन
हेलो. Hello. Yeah, I'm Vidyadhar Date. Hello. Hello, I'm Vidyadhar Date.
Sir, I'm Atul Gandhi from Reliance. I just have some few questions. Okay. See, I have the role of the BMC is basically to control and monitor and improve the quality of the citizens. So in that, basically, I have few questions. One thing is that you have rightly said that the garbage management...
We have a
management
number of people who are going to ask questions. I would be grateful if you restrict yourself to one question.
Yeah, I'm just coming
to the whole crowd here wants to ask questions.
I have only two questions on this. One thing is for quality of improving these things. You have said that the garbage segregation you have done. But at the end of the day, what is happening is that the society has started burning all these things and burning all the leaves and all the things at there. And they're increasing the carbon dioxide and the heat. Point number one. And second thing is I want to say that you are doing extensively concretization that has depleted in the groundwater. I think you have to address on these two issues. Because of these things also, the warming, global warming and the city warming has increased.
Yeah. As far as segregation of garbage and processing of garbage is concerned, we strongly believe end result has to come from, see, one thing we must all realize that this corporation belongs to the people of Mumbai. It employs 1,06,000 employees which are from Mumbai. We have not imported them from anywhere else. It belongs to the citizens. It's a part of the citizens. Whatever we do is part of the citizens, and citizens have to make this a success. It's not one person's responsibility or a group of 1 lakh people's responsibility to make it a success. Garbage must be processed. Now, if all of us decide to burn the garbage, there is very little that policing can do. Let us not take that as meaning that the administration is completely lost. No, every signal is not manned. But when a signal turns red, it's every citizen's responsibility to stop. Now, if you say, well, the end result of signals is what people are breaking signals, we are all responsible. I am as much responsible as you would be. So we need citizens also to be responsible on this, that let's also learn that burning is going to finally, who is going to get asthma? Not your neighbor. You will get it first, your neighbor will get it next. It's like smoking. You are going to get the cancer first, next is your family, and third is your neighbor. So please decide whether you still want to smoke or you don't want to smoke. By stopping selling of cigarettes is not helping us. Somebody will buy it, smuggle it, steal it. But we have to now learn what to do with these things. So fundamentally, somewhere along the line, we as citizens also have to realize that we have responsibilities.
Yeah, I'm Vidyadhar Date. It was a very good presentation, so I compliment you. But since the municipal corporation has so much surplus funds, can it not give some to the BST, which is really in a crisis? And world over, I mean, bus transport gets top priority.
So I'll come to the answer very quickly. Very good you raised this question. A lot of people ask me, everywhere in the world, the bus transport is subsidized. Yes, bus transport must be subsidized because the benefits from public transport are huge in terms of environment, in terms of decongesting roads, in terms of helping poor get to the places of work, improving employability of the city. I can go on and on telling you why public transport should be subsidized. We are all for giving subsidy. We have given it in so many words in writing. The budget document also says it in so many words. However, with a rider, We have told BST, we are not here to subsidize your inefficiency. We will subsidize the citizen, not your inefficiency. So if the bus costs 40 rupees or 60 rupees a kilometer to run, you run it at 60 rupees, and if your ticket is giving you only 30 rupees, please take the 30 rupees from us. But if you are going to run the bus at 100 rupees a kilometer, and the ticket cost is 30 rupees, and you are going to ask us to pay 70 rupees, sorry, it's not coming. It's not coming, because public money cannot be used to finance inefficiencies. It can be used to finance the people back. It's as clear as that.
Right, sir. So for the infrastructure, hello, sir. My name is Dweep. So for the infrastructure projects that you just listed out, you had already dipped into most of the reserve. So do you think the MCGM will have to look at other financial models to raise revenue? Financial instruments, basically, is what I meant. So say a municipal bond or value capture finance later on to fund big ticket infrastructure projects like this.
Yes, you know, as time goes on, Dweep, as you said very rightly, as time goes on, we will have to look for different funding sources. But presently, that's why we have very, very strategically decided to use our reserves only for capital. The minute I open the gate and say that this can be used for revenue, they'll start employing people. That is not what we are looking at. We are, as I keep telling a lot of people in the corporation, they don't like it. The corporation is not an employment guarantee scheme. We are not here to create employment. We are here to create assets. We are here to create a better life for the citizens. Let's be honest about that. So therefore, we are saying that this goes into capital. No, the beauty about putting money into capital is that it improves the quality of life, improves the index and the business capacity of that city. The minute you have better highways, better roads, better water supply, a better marine environment, there is more business. More business means a better property tax, a better taxation system, citizens who will then start walking out of subsidized things like education, subsidized hospitals. So citizens themselves, as their quality of life and their financial capacity goes up, they start walking out of the subsidized or the free services and they walk more into paid services. So increasing the capacity does help. That is what we are looking at. But yes, at some point of time, we may look at that.
Hello, sir. I'm Darshana Racha. I'm an urban planner from AILHC working for Mumbai DP. I have two questions. One is to improve the quality of education and increase the intake of students. Can we adopt some good practices like the Kejriwal government did? They had proposed three ideas. One is free education till 12th standard if a student is being studied in municipal school. Subsidized loans loans without interest for higher education and free loans for this merit-holding students. Those are the three things, and they also have adapted teachers training program. So can these good things be adopted to improve the quality of education?
Very clearly, in the Mumbai Corporation schools, education is free. As far as higher education is concerned, loans are available. Corporation's task is to first get people into the primary education system, which itself we are not able to do the way we want to do it.
Okay.
Fundamentally, what we are doing is there is an examination that has been created by the state government and by which they categorize the students. It goes like that. You know, how many students have scored above a certain level in number and communication skills. Now, we are making that compulsory and giving the target to every teacher that so, and those papers come from outside, go outside for correction. So we're now making it compulsory that your students will have to cross a particular level. They must cross a particular number skill level. So there are categories. So a class 8 student should be able to converse so much in English, so much in Marathi. He should be able to do so many basic mathematical calculations. So you must ensure that they cross that level. And that is something that why I said that quality of education, now those people involved in education, we are now setting a very stiff targets for them.
My second question is, it's a small question, sir.
Thank you, sir. So our Mumbai's slum area is huge. The small scale industries are there. I doesn't see or listen any type of budget for it. And my second question is, I so many times, last around 1 year, I am fighting for the our community toilet. I get answer, they don't have the budget. The totally budget is finished for this year. And we give answer them, the please give us the provision for the build the toilet. So we are ready to collect the fund from the locality.
Community toilets are concerned, there is no shortage of budget. I really don't know which toilet you're talking of. If you let me know, we'll find out why this is happening. But the problem that in toilets in Mumbai is not money. Money is not the issue. The issue is fundamentally land, space. Where do you build the toilets? And the problem is nobody wants a toilet next to his home. Everybody wants a toilet. Can I just finish? I agree. I'm not saying that what you're saying is not right, but I need to see that. Yes, I'm talking in a general this thing. Money is not the issue. So toilets, if you let me know the specific place, we will see that money is made available.
Yes, sir.
My suggestion is that the time limit, which is around 8 o'clock, should be extended to at least 10.
मेरा नाम दयानंद यादव है और प्रेरणा मंडल सीबीओ की ओर से मैं बात कर रहा हूँ। सर, कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट की जब हम बात करते हैं, एसएसपी की, जब हम पे एंड यूज टॉयलेट के लिए फ्री करने की बात, मगर वो मेंटेन करने के लिए हम 10 करोड़ का बजट प्रोवाइड करते, मगर एसएसपी के लिए जो लाइट और पानी की वजह से दिन ब दिन खराब होते जा रहे हैं, जो भी सीबीओ है, जहाँ पे भी सीबीओ बने हुए हैं, वो इसलिए ख़राब हो रहे हैं कि सीबीओ के पास पैसे नहीं है लाइट और पानी के बिल भरने के लिए, और दिन पे दिन लगभग 700 से 800 टॉयलेट ऐसे बने हुए जिनकी हालत खस्ता हो जा रही है। बजट में इसके लिए कोई प्रोविज़न ऐसी नज़र नहीं आई है।
ऐसा है, टॉयलेट्स के दो प्रकार हैं। एक तो है पे एंड यूज़ टॉयलेट, जिसका मालक कोई भी नहीं है। आप आज इधर आए हैं, आपने यहाँ का टॉयलेट यूज़ किया, कल आप मुलुंड जाएंगे तो मुलुंड का यूज़ किया, परसों आप बोरीवली में आए, बोरीवली का टॉयलेट यूज़ करेंगे, इसका कोई मालिक नहीं। एक फ्लोटिंग पॉपुलेशन है, तो इसके लिए तो हमें पे एंड यूज़ को फ्री कर रहे हैं ताकि ये फ्लोटिंग पॉपुलेशन इधर उधर ना करते हुए उधर ही जाना चाहिए। वो रोज़ उसको नहीं यूज़ करता, और अगर वो टॉयलेट पेड हो या अच्छा ना हो तो ओपन में जाएगा वो। सीबीओ बेस्ड जो टॉयलेट्स हैं वो कम्युनिटी में है। हम चाहते हैं कि उसका इनिशियल हम बना दें, पर कम्युनिटी मस्ट ओन इट। अगर कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट हम मेंटेन करने लग जाएं, समझो एक मिनट के लिए हम ये मान लें, तो फिर मेरे घर का टॉयलेट क्यों नहीं मेंटेन करती कॉरपोरेशन?
बिल्कुल,
हम ये चाहते हैं वो कम्युनिटी के लिए बनाए, हम ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा नए कम्युनिटी टॉयलेट्स बनाएं और कम्युनिटी उसको मेंटेन करें। हाँ, कभी जब मेजर रिपेयर्स निकलेंगे,
एग्जैक्टली सर,
तो मेजर रिपेयर्स हम लोग अब हर एक दो तीन चीज़ें हमने की हैं। पहले टॉयलेट्स में वाटर और बिजली का नहीं था, वो हमने एक बहुत बड़ा प्रोग्राम लिया है। स्ट्रक्चरल ऑडिट करवाया हर टॉयलेट का, कि जो पीछे दो बहुत बुरे एक्सीडेंट्स हुए मुंबई में जो नहीं होने चाहिए थे, तो अब स्ट्रक्चरल ऑडिट करवाया है हमने टॉयलेट्स का, और जहाँ जहाँ उसको रिपेयर करना है उसका भी एक कार्यक्रम हाथ में ले रहे हैं। बट अगर कोई कहे कि उसकी सफाई और रोज का खर्चा कॉरपोरेशन करे, मुझे तो नहीं लगता कि ये उचित होगा।
सर, आई वुड फर्स्ट वांट टू थैंक यू फॉर बीइंग सो पेशेंट, वंडरफुल टॉक, एंड देन बीइंग टेकिंग सो मेनी डाइवर्स क्वेश्चंस। But so one thing is that in a related with both water and sanitation, we have done a very comprehensive study on the public and community toilets in Mumbai, and in visits to many slums in Mumbai, what I found is that when there is no provision of sewerage connectivity in those slums, the water bill that each slum dweller has to pay has about 45%, if I'm not wrong, of a component of sewerage tax. So something that I have not able to figure out is that how can a person be liable to pay for a service that he doesn't have? So that is one question. And the other thing is, sir, about water and a very important big mega project that the BMC is undertaking on Garga in Pinjal, 16,000 odd crore, it's what is estimated cost for it. Sir, in 2007-8, Mumbai had two multiple years in succession of very poor monsoon. And that led to some great crisis, 50% water cut on a daily basis. And in 2010, we did a study on the water supply scenario in Mumbai, the BMC per se. And in those days, the non-revenue water or the water loss was pegged at around 650 to 700 million liters per day. And in 2012-13, if I'm correct, under Mumbai Project 3A, the Middle Vaitarna project started, got commissioned. and Mumbai started getting additional 455 million liters of water per day. And that brought the supply up to 3,700 that we still currently have. Now that project cost was 2,700 crore. But in the budget speech given by Municipal Commissioner Subodh Kumar in 2013-14, the amount of non-revenue water or the water loss was pegged at 900 million liters per day. Now this is humongous and absolutely unsustainable for any city. Now which translates into a simple mathematical calculation that 455 MLD that was brought in by Middle Vaitarna, we are losing double of that 900 MLD every day, so which translates to around 4,500 crore worth of, like, you know, a mega project going down the drain every day in Bombay. And now we are talking about increasing water supply, bringing about, I think, 3,400 odd MLD from Garga and Pinjal both. Also, interlinking of the Daman Ganga and Pinjal project. So the question is, sir, without really making your water supply system robust enough, is it really wise to make such mega projects and commission such mega projects? Because the additional water is likely to feed the leaks more than really the people of Mumbai. So those two questions. Thank you.
Quickly, Dhawal. First thing, the non-revenue water now is about 27%. So if you translate 27% to about 3,700 million liters, so it comes to about one fifth of the total water that we are supplying. But however, when my people gave me the statistics, I look at it with great suspicion. Let me be honest about the organization that I head. I come from the power sector, where the life of the power sector is metering. That's your bread and butter, is metering. Every unit of electricity we meter, and the kind of emphasis, in fact, there's a whole department which looks at metering. There's a metering at the generation level, there's a metering at the substation level, the EHV level, residential levels. The kind of metering, the kind of statistics that are generated on that is amazing. So when I come from that sector, water is nothing but electricity. It's a liquid electricity. The metering levels are extremely poor. So when we say that this much water has gone and this much water is there, I would only shrug my shoulders and say, well, I for one won't stand for those figures. The issue here is, first issue, in fact, that's one thing that this time's budget we have done. By the end of next year, I have said that first thing, let us meter bulk water. Let's start. Metering at residential and domestic level is very poor today. Let's be very honest, the quality of meters, the type of meters, the meter reading, the cycle of meter reading, that's all a very different game altogether. But let us first start with bulk metering. At least I know to begin with that a ward received so much of water. Let's start with that. So till I get my metering in place, for me to hazard a guess that how much water is actually being lost or not. So we're getting our metering in, that metering act in place, that's one. Second, as far as leaks are concerned, again, in the last two budgets, we have been putting in a lot of efforts on what is called removing bunch of connections. We are trying to see that everything is not stand post. Because again, stand post, most of the stand post water may be even accounted as NR water for all you know. I really do not know. I really do not know what is happening there. So if once we start giving individual connections, you have a much better control on metering and quantity of water. That's the second thing that we are looking at, and also removal of leakages. However, having said that, there is still a need to increase the amount of water. To say that the amount of water that is going to be increased is only going into the leakages, that may be not correct, because there are areas still, slums and all, where the water supply levels are still very, very low. We need to enhance. And as slum redevelopment takes place and people move into houses, water consumptions are going to rise. Individual connections are coming up. So definitely we are looking at that. But yes, there is a case to ensure that leakages stop. Metered, then we have to have a legal mechanism of collecting money, because there is a service that you are using. So you are using stand post water, you are using a sewer system in some way or the other. So there has to be a mechanism. So either you collect it as a service charge through metering. So the other methodology is the law allows us is collected through a tax. So we collect it through what is called a sewage tax in case there is no connection over there or there is no metered connection.